We'll go ahead and get started if everyone is ready. Good morning and welcome to worship this morning at Christ Lutheran Church. This is the 16th Sunday after Pentecost, and we are celebrating Rally Day today. If you're joining us online, why did I look back at the screen? I don't know. I should be looking that way. Welcome. Thank you for celebrating with us this morning. I'm A.J. Striffler. I'm a Lutheran pastor who is also a Navy chaplain. Pastor Keith is on the mainland doing some visits and getting ready to celebrate the ordination of longtime friend of the congregation, Sina. And I don't remember Sina's last name. Norton. Sina Norton. So we celebrate with her and for the good people that she will be serving as pastor. And we're glad Pastor Keith gets to be there with her for that special occasion. Our service this morning will begin with the confession and forgiveness. And I invite you to rise if you are able, and we'll go ahead and get started. Did you have something to play? Or did you do that? Okay. I'm remembering back to another service where Pastor Keith welcomed everyone and then stopped so that more music could be played. And then when I did that at the early service, and I wanted to make sure I didn't cut Tom off from something. So the confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My siblings in Christ, let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Let us hear the gospel together. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to each of us the entire forgiveness of our sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Forgiven, refreshed, renewed, transformed, we raise our voices in song and sing our opening song, the gathering song, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. Thank you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of Holy Spirit be with you all. Epule kako, let us pray. O Lord God, merciful judge, you are the inexhaustible fountain of forgiveness. Replace our hearts of stone with hearts that love and adore you, that we might delight in doing your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. So please be seated as we share the lessons from Holy Scripture.
A reading from Genesis. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, 'I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you.' Now, therefore, "Please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him, and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join in reading responsively the psalm. Lord, you are full of compassion and mercy. You will not always accuse us. You have not dealt with us according to our sins,
nor repaid us according to our iniquities.
For as the heavens are high above the earth,
so great is your steadfast love for those who fear you.
As far as the east is from the west,
so far have you removed our transgressions from us.
As a father has compassion for his children,
so you have compassion for those who fear you.
A reading from Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also, those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then, each of us will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to Matthew. We are battling the wind a little bit this morning, so bear with us. Peter came and said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times. But I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 5,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything." And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave the debt. But that slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him a few hundred denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, "Pay what you owe." Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." But he refused. And then he went and threw him in prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord what had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have mercy on your fellow slave as I have mercy on you?" And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Are you doing this cakey story? Rally around rally day? Keith said nothing to me about.
I didn't know.
Well, you know, I talk about it in the sermon, so are we okay just to?
Yeah.
All right. I tell you, it's never a surprise working with that guy. I mean, it's never not a surprise working. See, you all are shaking your heads like you know exactly what I'm talking about. I have gone digital. Yes. I was telling some folks earlier that I was one of the first pastors to walk around with a tablet and preach from the tablet. And it was new and it was modern, and people thought it was either great or they absolutely hated it, you know, like we do in the church when something new gets introduced. But back then, it was really difficult to get the software on one thing to communicate with the software on another thing. So it became so much work that I just stopped doing it. But now, right, with Saint Apple, it's so easy to do all that. So here we are. So aloha and good morning to you. Today is Rally Sunday. Let me hear it. Yay. I love that. Who did the Yahoo? All right. Yeah, they're both. So Rally Sunday is a fun little name that a lot of churches use on the first Sunday, sort of after a summer schedule and a summer lull ends. We slow down for the summer as folks travel and play baseball and rugby and soccer and all that kind of stuff. And then we rally to get everything back on track, right? To get back into the swing of normal church life. Rally Sunday also usually signifies the start of Sunday school. And not just Sunday school, but Christian education, again, in the life of a congregation. So just like the secular school year takes a break, right, in the summer months, the church generally slows down or stops most Sunday school and educational programs over the summer again so people can travel and enjoy time off and relax and just appreciate a slower pace during the warmer months. Go to the beach, you know, hang 10, do what we do here in Hawaii, and refresh and renew for the work and the programs to come. Now again, Sunday school, synonymous with Christian education, although geared towards children generally, is really quite important to all of us, child and adult, and all the spectrum of in between. It shouldn't matter how many children might or might not take part in a formalized program with posters and colorful banners and music and story, although those things are wonderful and fun and eye-catching. All of us share in the celebration of and participation in an intentional Christian community's education program because, right, despite all of our best appearances, and let's face it, wars are started and fought over appearances, we all need work. In this being Christian thing. If truth be told, none of us is an expert. There's always room to grow deeper and to grow stronger in our knowledge and our discipleship walk with Jesus. All of us are on a faith journey. And Christianity and Christian discipleship is a lifelong practice, a lifelong discipline. See, discipleship, discipline. See, right? Whether we are young or whether we are older, we are always being invited to renew and always being invited to transform our wills, our lives. The world around us is always twisting us one way, encouraging us down one path, while the Spirit of God keeps nudging us towards God's invitation to another path, a path of life. A path of compassion and empathy, a path of renewal and transformation, a path of forgiveness and restoration. I'm not sure we ever really get great at any of this stuff. There's never a graduation ceremony that says, "You've completed your course of study." We don't take licensing exams to follow Jesus. We just keep at it. We keep moving and we keep struggling with the challenges. Because life and people, and sometimes the people in our lives, are challenging. And sometimes we do really, really well, right? And sometimes we don't do as well as we should. But God keeps inviting. And with the help of the Spirit, we keep on that path of transformation and renewal. We keep working at it intentionally. Hopefully, because God keeps welcoming us, and God keeps calling us, and God keeps inviting us, keeps speaking to us words of hope. And the journey goes on, and the path continues. You know, once upon a time, world-famous cellist, Pablo Casals, was asked when he was well in his 80s if he still practiced his cello every day. And when he answered, claro que sí, yes, of course, they asked him, well, why? You're Pablo Casals. Because I think I'm making progress, he answered. Hopefully, prayerfully, we are making progress too. You know, back in the 80s, there was a great, great movie made. Back in the 80s. Seems like yesterday, right? This movie was the movie of my young teenage years, right? And it was beloved of me and my cousins, and because we grew up in the same household, so we were more like brothers. And I mean, this really just defined a whole portion of our life, The Karate Kid, right? Teenager from Jersey finds himself relocated to California, befriends the caretaker of his apartment complex where he and his single mother live, right? Mr. Miyagi is his name, played by the talented and unforgettable Mr. Pat Morita. The kid, Daniel, played by the rather more forgettable Ralph Macchio, gets beaten up by kids at school who all study martial arts together. Mr. Miyagi from Okinawa offers to teach Daniel karate. Daniel shows up to Mr. Miyagi's house expecting his first lesson, but instead he is made to wash and wax the many classic cars in Mr. Miyagi's collection. In circular motions with his hands, he is instructed by Miyagi. If you know it, say it with me. Wax on, wax off. Right, you all know this. And he must do that repetitively until all the cars are completed. Wax on, wax off. Now, after the cars, Miyagi, who has built a traditional wooden, beautiful Japanese-style home/oasis, right, has Daniel sand the floor. Again, circular movements with both hands, this time in opposite directions, until the entire deck and floor of this vast, beautiful space are done. After the floor, Daniel must paint the fence with specific up and down motions, bending only at the wrist, keeping the hand straight. Then he must paint the house side to side. Again, specific side to side motions. He does this for hours, days, probably weeks. The movie doesn't really tell us how long, but you're meant to just imagine that this has consumed this young man's entire summer. Finally, Daniel, who has been expecting to learn karate, gets really frustrated and feels extremely overutilized. When he confronts Miyagi, rather emotionally, Miyagi demonstrates that he has been teaching Daniel karate the whole time. The specific choreographed repetitive movements have taught Daniel how to block almost any kick or punch that will come at him. It is a very climactic and satisfying moment in the movie. In the gospel, Jesus tells the disciples a parable of forgiveness. But not just a parable of forgiveness, it's also a parable of communal accountability and restoration. A servant owes his master, his king, 10,000 talents. This is already an impossible and far-fetched story. because this is an extraordinary, astronomical, impossible amount of money. We can presume that Jesus is using the exaggeration to help make a point. Anyway, when the servant cannot repay the debt, he is told that he and his family will be sold to someone else in order that the master can recoup the lost money. Then the servant begs and pleads, you know, for mercy, and he receives mercy. And that ridiculous, astronomical NASA level amount of money is forgiven. What? Just gone. Then the newly unburdened servant runs into a fellow servant who owes him some pocket change. You know, the kind you find at the bottom of your purse or in your sofa, you know, when you're cleaning out the popcorn and crumbs. Nothing. When that fellow cannot repay that measly sum, the debt forgiven servant has him severely punished, extraordinarily punished, ridiculously, over the top, the punishment in no way, no how fits the crime, punished. When the other servants learn about it, they go and they complain to the king. Now the king, who has just forgiven the man extraordinarily, holds him accountable for his actions. And as such, his debt is reimposed upon his person, and he is locked away and tortured. And what does that mean? Locked away and tortured until he can repay his debt. But he can't repay his debt because he's locked away and tortured. In the end, the one who was forgiven and the one who was restored did not, in turn, forgive and restore. The outcome is exaggerated consequences, but the entire situation was exaggerated from the start. The point is that there are consequences. Demonstrating that implicit in forgiveness is accountability. Accountability to oneself, accountability to the communities to which you and the others belong, and most importantly, accountability to God. Now, Peter has recognized the overall profundity of what Jesus is telling them about forgiveness. And in true Peter fashion, he begins this exchange by frustratedly blurting out, "Well, how many times exactly do I have to forgive someone who busts my chops and sins against me?" Right? Do I have to do it as many as 7 times? To which Jesus responds, no, not 7 times. 77 times. Or 70 times 7. We're not really 100% sure how to translate that this section, but that's not really the point. The point is that the movement to forgiveness, the act of forgiving, should be fluid. And it should be natural from us, like walking or breathing. The act of restoring someone to community in their own fullness should be everything that we are about, because it is everything that Jesus is about. Like Mr. Miyagi in Wax On, Wax Off, the Christian practice of forgiveness is biblically definitive of who Jesus was and who we are called to be. We practice forgiveness to get good at it. Are you good yet? Yeah, me either. We practice forgiveness to get good at it. And there are reasons forgiveness is necessary and practical when we live in intentional communities of faith and beyond. Forgiveness removes labels and boundaries around people that stifle the total expression of their personhood and weigh them down with burden that prevents them from growing into all of God's possibilities and dreams for them. And likewise, by preventing others from flourishing, by holding people back from God's hope and possibility for their life, we prevent all the ways that everyone in the community will be made better by them and by their gifts. When we forgive someone, we remove labels and tear down walls. We restore people to possibility, and we free ourselves, our lives, our communities, for the generosity and the gift of their blessing. We continually, repetitively practice forgiveness because it brings us closer to God and God's hopes and God's dreams for all. Not the act of forgiving, but the consequence. When we forgive another, we also learn to appreciate and understand the power of God's forgiveness in and to and for us. It becomes personal and liberating and empowering for us and for our own lives. We become overwhelmed with God's unfathomable love for us. And in our own sense of appreciation for that and our overwhelming gratitude for God's compassion and mercy, we are restored to our own fullness, our own total personhood, so that we can participate in the glorious work of restoring others. When Miyagi-san demonstrates to Daniel everything that he has learned through the hours of manual waxing and sanding and painting, without his even being aware that he was learning it, he no longer has to think about the right way to move, or the right way to bend his knees, or the right way to stand. The movement, the action, the response is natural. It is fluid. It comes to him easily as if it were second nature. And this is exactly what Jesus means when he answers Peter's question about forgiving someone 7 times. No, Peter, not 7 times. Not 77 times. Not even 70 times 7. But until it is fluid and authentic and second nature, until, Peter, you can forgive, and until you can restore someone without thinking, Until the forgiveness you have received, Peter, pours forth out of you abundantly like life-giving water from a deep and eternal well. Until you can release someone, anyone, from labels and chains and be glad and look forward to everything they will become. Everything you will become. That, Peter, is how many times you need to forgive someone who has sinned against you. Only then, Peter, only then, church, will you know what it means to forgive. Only then will we know what it means to be forgiven. Only then will we truly know forgiveness. Wax on, wax off. Amen. Our hymn of the day, forgive us, forgive our sins as we forgive. Our service continues now with the Apostles' Creed. We confess our faith and join together as the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church and bear witness to each other and to the world. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Dear friends, united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, we are joined in God's mission for the life of the world. We are called to that mission in our daily lives and in the ministries we share as the Church of God. Today it is our privilege to recognize and support those who are engaged in the work of this congregation, especially those in the ministry of education to our keiki. And so I invite you to rise if that is your work. Very excellent. Our brave and our fearless Sunday school leaders. Siblings in Christ, both your work and your rest are in God. Will you endeavor to pattern your life on the Lord Jesus Christ in gratitude to God and in service to others as you carry out the ministry of education in this congregation, Christ Lutheran Church? People of God, I ask you, will you support these your siblings in Christ in their service? And will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all who are baptized? If so, please say, we will, and we ask God to help us.
We will, and we ask God to
help us. Epule kako, let us pray. O God of wisdom, in your goodness, you provide faithful teachers for your church. Bless those who serve as Keiki Church teachers. Help us all to study your word and engage your world, that together we may grow in knowledge and love. Pursue what is good and seek to do your will through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We give you thanks, O God, for all who respond to the call to serve in your name. Give them joy and fulfillment, care and guidance in their tasks. Help us all to give willingly and to receive thankfully the gifts of ministry that your name may be glorified, your people live in peace, and your will be done. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Thank you. And I think we should give our Keiki Sunday School teachers a round of thankful applause. We'll continue now with the prayers of the church.
Remembering the caring and generous works of God, we pray for the church, creation, and the needs of our neighbors. We pray for the church. Bless the missions and ministries of diverse congregations, that they uplift the good news of salvation in ways that can be understood. E ka haku. We pray for creation. Send rain to lands experiencing drought and healing to rivers clogged with pollution. Enrich the soil for trees and plants. Protect the crops needed to feed those who hunger. E ka haku. We pray for all who govern. Encourage those in positions of power to lead with empathy, practice forgiveness, and care for those who struggle. E ka haku. We pray for our neighbors who face illness of any kind, for those strained financially, for all living with chronic pain, mental illness, the disease of addiction, or otherwise afraid or in harm's way. Protect all who cry out for mercy, especially all those whom we now pray for silently and aloud. All those with COVID, Alice, Anita, Benny, Bonnie, Christina, Karen, Craig, Dick, Don, Elaine, Gary, Glenn, Hal, Naomi, Ian, Jerry, Jim, Joanne, Kathy, Kim, Lahela, Mary, the Mellon family, Michael, Hattie, Peggy, Richard, Rose, Star, Steph, Yvonne, Steve, and Tilly. E ka haku. We pray for this congregation, Christ Lutheran Church. Open our hearts to practice intentional invitation. Help us to forgive each other, practice patience, and choose welcome over judgment. Move us to care for those in our community seeking refuge and safety. E ka haku. We pray for those who are celebrating birthdays this week, including Ritter and Leaf. May their days be filled with laughter, love, and joy. E ka haku. We pray for Lutheran Church of Holy Trinity and their pastor, Brian Kieser. May they be faithful witnesses to God's word. E ka haku. We give thanks for the saints who died in faith. Show us how to live faithfully, creatively, and lovingly in your church and world, like Hildegard, Abbess of Bingen, whom we commemorate today. E ka haku. Remember us according to your steadfast love as we offer these and the prayers of our heart, trusting in your compassion made known through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Friends and neighbors, sisters and brothers, all my siblings, the peace of Christ be with you always. And I invite you to share a sign of that peace with one another. And as you continue peacing with each other, just a quick note, the congregation is forever grateful for the intentional gifts of money that you give to support the work and the building and this place as a seat of the gospel and a beacon of hope for the world. Thank you for continually just sharing with such great generosity. We'll now sing our offertory as I finish preparing the table.
Let us pray. God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation, and multiply your graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Siblings in Christ, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection has opened to us the way of everlasting living. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and he gave thanks. He broke it and he shared it with his friends, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and he gave it to his friends to drink, saying, "This cup is the new promise in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come, all is ready, and you are welcome. At home and are prepared to receive communion with us. The assisting minister and I are going to commune each other up here and join us as we commune. Thank you.
Epule kako, let us pray. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world, through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Are there any announcements? I know that there's a quick council meeting starting right now. So if that is where you need to be, go be. Anything else? Anything, Becky, about Sunday school? Always fun to have more bodies. Anything else? We will go forth with God's blessing and then sing our sending song. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord's face shine upon us with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. Amen. And God be with you till we meet again. Have a blessed week, everyone. Let us go in peace and forgiveness. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.